This is me. And this is my fiance. Together we decided to explore a little bit of South America. In our journey, we follow the rise and fall of past civilizations, each built upon the ruins of their ancient predecessors. Together with the myths and stories that held them together, we go in search for the meaning of civilization, both modern and forgotten. How do cultures in some of the world's most inhospitable landscapes create such amazing civilizations, perfecting agricultural techniques and creating architecture unproducible even by modern standards? And just as mysteriously as they appeared, they vanished whence they came, leaving behind no written record. Along the Andean Cordillera, through the Altiplano, valleys, and deep into the Amazonian jungle, we go in search for these answers.
And we're back with breaking news out of South America. Today, the organization Survival International released photographs of an isolated tribe taken within the Peruvian Amazon. Through these newly taken images, the non-governmental organization is reporting risks incurred by encountering this indigenous group. The pictures, which were taken last November near Manu National Park, show a family of the Masco Piro tribe along the Madre de Dios River, of which only a very few people have ever been able to approach. Researchers are estimating that this community has around 60 members, among them 25 adults. With increasing illegal deforestation and air traffic linked to gas and oil exploitation, their way of life and culture are becoming ever more threatened.
Las nuevas imágenes han surgido de una tribu aislada en la selva amazónica de Perú, conocida como Masco Piro. Los intentos anteriores de hacer contactos han dado lugar a enfrentamientos mortales y ahora las autoridades están aconsejando a la gente que evite ir a ninguna parte cerca de ellos. Este material recientemente obtenido muestra a los miembros de la tribu a lo largo de la orilla del río que corre con sus arcos y flechas dibujadas. Y la semana pasada, un guardaparques fue herido por un disparo de advertencia. La frecuencia de avistamientos de tribus aisladas han ido aumentando en el Perú en los últimos años debido a la deforestación ilegal, la minería y las compañías petroleras cada vez más generalizada en la región de Madre de Dios. A pesar de las protestas públicas para proteger a estas comunidades indígenas, el gobierno peruano aún tiene que cumplirlas.
For years, explorers have searched for a mysterious city of gold hidden within the jungles of Peru. And now researchers claim to have stumbled across Paya-Titi, the lost Inca city of gold. These ruins were found near Cuzco, the once capital of the Incan Empire. Legends state that Paya-Titi housed temples, shrines, and altars made of pure gold. Many have lost their lives in search of this fabled city. Although researchers found no gold here, they did uncover intricately cut stones, buildings, tunnel systems, and ceremonial altars.
From Cusco, we made an arduous journey into the Madre de Dios, meaning Mother of God, a name befitting of an unforgiving landscape. It was here that many explorers disappeared, never to be seen or heard from again. It has been long believed that the Inca did not enter into the Amazon. The edge of their empire ended at an outpost called Bucartambo. However, as people slowly began encroaching deeper into the Amazon, they began to find the same intricate Incan roads leading into the Amazonian region of the Madre de Dios. We journey into the Amazon in search of clues of a lost city that is said to exist deep inside the jungle. Our expedition will take us to Pacharo, an isolated archaeological site which consists of a large wall covered in petroglyphs. Some people claim that Pacharo is the gateway to Paya-Titi, the mysterious city of gold. It is said that only a spiritually elevated individual will be able to understand and decipher the meanings on the wall, and only then will they gain access to the hidden city. Otherwise, the doorway will remain closed for all others. There is but one road leading into the Amazon, and there are no other options. The drive itself is roughly 10 hours on a one-lane, unpaved dirt road that winds dangerously alongside the edge of cliffs. During the rainy season, sections of the road get washed out in landslides, which becomes rather evident while driving through the infamous cloud forest to reach the beginning of the Amazon. We began to see large communities. However, the deeper we traveled, the smaller the communities became, until finally the road came to an end. Here, many people have escaped modern living in exchange for a rural lifestyle. Many mestizos and indigenous, unable to afford a stable livelihood in the main cities and towns, have come here as a last resort in hopes of a new beginning. This region of the Amazon maintains the largest levels of biodiversity in the world, which are now contained within a biosphere reserve labeled as Mandum National Park. The further into the jungle we would travel, the further away we moved from civilization. There have been several maps found over the years depicting this as being the area of Paititi, the El Dorado. In recent years, they have uncovered several documents dating back to the early 17th century, including one found within the Vatican archives, describing this as being the location of Paititi. Legends state that Paititi is situated in a 10 days journey from Cusco in the direction of the rising sun, which is roughly the location we find ourselves now. Once in the port of Santa Cruz, along the Madre de Dios River, we obtained special permission to proceed into a government-protected zone. It was along this same river that the Mashcopiro would be seen. The Mashcopiro are a tribe of uncontacted indigenous people who, by choice, distance themselves from the modern world. Occasionally, they make requests for simple supplies, such as machetes, pots, pans, and food, though they themselves are not known to plant food for resources. Unlike many of the local indigenous Machiganga natives and mestizos here who have adapted to life in between two worlds, the Mashcopiro remain in isolation and are known to attack outsiders encroaching on their land. There have been several skirmishes fought against invading loggers, drug traffickers, and oil company employees who have entered into their territory, and similarly, locals have been attacked with rocks and arrows while commuting along the Madre de Dios River. In late 2011, our guide and his expedition team were on the Madre de Dios River when they spotted the Mashcopiro. They were slightly upriver from where we roughly find ourselves now when they spotted the Mashcopiro on the other side of the river. It was from here that the infamous images of the Mashcopiro were taken, by placing the camera over the opening of a high-powered telescope. This is what they captured. Here are some never-before-seen photos of the Mashcopiro, taken by Professor Jean-Paul Van Bell. One of the members of his expedition, by the name of Nicolás Chaco Flores, shown here in one of the photos, was considered one of the last people who knew how to speak their language. However, he was later killed by the Mashkopiro, less than a month after this photograph was taken. Here is a first-hand account of the events that took place that day.
Pero él me cuenta que sí, tenía necesidades de que le dé machete, ollas, cuchillos, y totalmente que ya no podría darle, porque tenía una parte de machetes, así. Pero que la última vez que muera, que la había amenazado, indicando que si tú no me das machete, te voy a matar. La había amenazado para que lo mate. Entonces nos hemos ido, yo con él y mi esposa que está acá. Ella sí sabe hablar su idioma. A las 8:15 y me dijo que vamos al frente. Y entonces no creo que salga porque ya el día sábado ha salido, porque él tenía contado días hasta cuando va a estar ahí. Entonces nos hemos ido. Y de ella nos hemos ido. Me dijo que el señor me dijo, este va a sacar yuca. Y mi hija ya va, escarbando, tú vas a estar macheteando. Y yo voy a ir a ver allá cómo está y si está viniendo, y entonces para quitarnos y para irnos al frente. Y estaba yendo macheteando, y un momento que escuchaba el grito de que corrieron agarrando su pecho. Llegando casi como 20 a 30 metros y se cayó. Le pregunté a mi esposa, ¿qué pasó, Pepe? De repente ella que me dijo, ella me decía que no se ha escuchado que mi papá que la ha picado, le ha flechado Pepe Mágico. Y entonces se había muerto, sin correr más allá, y han corrido y se ha caído, se ha muerto. Y de ella me dije mi esposa, a ver, mira, ay, si es mágico o qué ha pasado, de repente ha visto. Y había un tronco y me he subido ahí, ahí estaba para los mágicos. Son 7 varones y 6 mujeres. Y estaba ahí, y el otro, porque tenía una flecha y entonces, como no tenía, entonces el otro que estaba parado hacia atrás y me señala a mí, hay otro allá, y hay que... Y le manda el otro para que me corretee a flechar. Y de ahí me he escapado. He dejado con mi perrito. Y mi perrito estaba ahí donde estaba la yuca que estaba escarbando mi esposa. Pero felizmente el perro que ya tenía una... que él estaba aprovechando mientras que yo me estuve escapando. Y entonces mi esposa pensé que, porque yo no me recordaba a mi esposa que sí, y para escaparnos junto con ella, yo esperé, o sea que ya me había escapado total. Ya escuché que el perro que la había flechado. Y de mi esposa se ha escapado de mí atrás y llegó Pedro. Nos hemos ido los dos, nos hemos escapado. Y luego nosotros estamos en la orilla del río sentados ahí. Mientras que piensa que nosotros íbamos a ir por otro sitio, ya rodea todo el lugar. Pero yo estuve sentado y que me salió. Y luego, ¿cómo se llama? Como yo tenía bote con esa embarcación que me ha ido a traer yuca, y intenté sacarla este bote. Y hay un momento, puchete, todo a mí me atacaron. O sea, que quería matarme, flecharme, pero mejor yo que me avivé un poquito, me metí dentro del agua. De ahí me sumido, me salió más abajito, porque ellos estaban esperando, piensa que voy a o sea, sumir y salir. Y entonces me he ido abajo. Y de ahí me salí al frente. De al frente ya intenté sacarle a mi esposa y estuve agarrando mi balsita para bandear otra vez. Pero ya ese rato ya llegaba un bote de turismo. Y me preguntó, porque yo, o sea, verdaderamente que me había asustado. Entonces, como me ha preguntado y qué pasó, le conté todo, y entonces mira, pasó este accidente y murió el tío, el pionero de diamante, Nicolás Flores. Y después de eso, y entonces para salvar a mi mujer, y entonces me apresaba bote y los pasajeros bajaron, y entonces solo un motorista, y tenía miedo para que me acompañe. Y entonces el otro tripulante y me acompañó, y entonces le saqué todo, y felizmente que no la ha matado mi hijo. Se salvaron, y entonces ellos estaban, seguían en el parando. No llamando, sabes. Seguía llamando, ven, así. Como no me entendía, no sé, que no entendía su idioma, y entonces que me diría, ven, ya no voy a flechear, así. Pero lo que estaba caminando y seguía con su flecha. Veniendo y poniendo acá el arco y su flecha a la estampa. Cuando uno te acerca y hay coger y hay flechear. Y así fue lo que los más que le ha matado a mi suegro. Y todo ha venido sus familiares a levantar cara. Y ese momento estaba el río crecido y no podíamos coger ellos. Y se bandearon y se escaparon. Entonces, hasta ahora que ya no voy a ir. Y sigue lo que me cuenta que está en el puesto mágico, sigue saliendo.
Shortly after the filming of this interview, the Mashkopito were again sighted for the second time in less than 2 years, this time asking nearby villagers for food. After the encounter, government officials again reminded the people not to go near them, as any disease could easily kill them due to lack of immunities.